In this episode, I'll talk about the structure of metals and the properties achieved in additive manufacturing. Here I have a couple of examples of additively produced metal parts. We have this little piece, or these two, that are done with powder bed fusion, that really show laser powder bed fusion, that show the complexity and the little detail that you can achieve with these air ducts and just this sphere. Then a keychain that was produced with powder bed fusion using electron beam. And then we have two other examples that are a little bit more exotic. This is a cast part that was produced in a binder jet printed sand mold. And this is a part produced, could be binder jetting, so a metal powder that's binded together by a polymer, but in this particular case, it's material extrusion process from desktop metal that that uses a polymer binder, a thermoplastic polymer binder that's highly filled with metal particles, and the part is built up during the material extrusion process, and then a sintering process follows. But that's just a different way of build-up, but it's particles that are sintered together afterwards. That's the most important part. And so far, I've talked a lot about polymers, and the difference really between polymers and metals is the molecular structure. For polymers, we now know a lot about these long molecular chains and giant molecules and so on. And metals, we have lattice structures that are composed of atoms, and lattices are ordered layers that form three-dimensional crystalline structure. And we have a very regularly repeating pattern. We have three examples of different crystal lattice structures that we can see: the cubic body-centered, the cubic face-centered, and the hexagonal structure. And with all of these, you see a difference in the packing pattern and the packing density. And this has a huge effect also on the ductility of the material. So the properties of metals depend on the lattice structure that they form, and the properties, and thus the lattice structure, can be altered through heat treatments that are done after the metal part was produced. And that's traditionally done in metal works, but it's also something that's done with additively manufactured metal parts. Metals, in comparison to polymers, are much heavier. They have a higher density, but they have a very high strength to weight ratio, so specific strength. And they also have a high strength to stiffness ratio, specific modulus. That is true if you compare it, for example, to just regular polymers. It's a little different when you compare it to fiber-reinforced polymers, and in particular with continuous fibers. Then these composites aim to outperform even metals, and they're lighter. That's why the specific properties are better. But in general, metals are the strongest materials that we had for a very long time. They're easy to machine and post-process, not only because of their properties, but we have a long history in metal processing and metal manufacturing. So there's a lot of technologies out there that improve and tailor the properties that we get in a product. Because metal needs to be melted at higher temperatures, and it's so tough and hard and rigid, we have high energy consumption when we're processing it, either with casting or machining. And the post-processing steps, so heat treatment or machining, are almost always necessary, in particular when we talk about additively manufactured parts. Here I'm giving really just a small intro to the structure of a metal. Bulk metals have a relatively perfect crystalline structure, and that structure is called grains. And you can actually see what grain means. It's like little distinct regions here within a component. The size and shape of the grains are directly related to the thermal mechanical history of the metal and has an effect on the yield strength, toughness, creep strength, and formability. And here depicted, you have the numbers 1, 2, 3 going also here over the cross-section. And 1 is really this very fine crystalline zone called the chill zone, which is the zone where the highest cooling rates are happening, the highest local undercooling, because that's in contact with the mold wall. And that forms the exogenous zone. Then followed by that further inward, also here, is the columnar zone, where you have oriented radial crystallization that's always parallel to the direction of the maximum temperature gradient. So if this is the wall, it's cooler, and we have the melt, the highest temperature in here, makes sense that these columns and grains are growing in this direction, because that's where the heat conduction goes. And then in the very center, depending how big a part that can be relatively small, we have an equiaxed zone that has a more coarse crystalline center zone, also called an endogenous zone. So that's the structure that we have in a part as we're typically producing it. But now you have to think of additive manufacturing, where we're not casting liquid, a huge chunk. Let's look at that. A huge chunk of metal into a mold, where we have that's probably 7 millimeters in diameter are these little features. And that's relatively massive. That would cool really rapidly and probably only have zones 1 and 2. And very, very small 3. But in additive manufacturing, we have this layer by layer, and we're reheating it. So we're not only cooling it rapidly, we're reheating it. So the heat treatment is already included in the process. That's important to remember. The way we look at metal structure is normally we look at the phase diagram and look how it's formed as it's going through the cooling process. That's what's the most interesting. And I put an example of a phase diagram, and it's definitely, I'm in the business field polymer, so metals are my forte. So I would highly recommend you do some additional reading if you're interested in that. This is a great resource. This is also where I got the images from. Phase diagram really means that the way the material forms its grain structure and solidifies depends on the temperature, chemical composition, and the pressure it sees. And in a phase diagram, that's depicted in the following way. Here you see the temperature, and on the x-axis, the content of carbon that's in that material. And it's a phase diagram of an iron material. And you see, depending on the carbon content, as the material is cooling, it's going through these different phases and form different structures. And I like this depiction in particular, because it gives you also an idea of the grain structure size and how that will look. And it shows these transition temperatures that give you an idea of the metallurgical structure of the phases. So when it goes through here, it has an austenite formation and is still liquid. Or when here it's completely austenite. That is very important to understand the properties. And then we can also look at the effect that an annealing process, so a subsequent thermal treatment, has on the material. And you can see in these different zones, if you just hold a material, it's also an iron, so it's an outtake of this. If you just hold a material that has a carbon content of less than 2%, around 600 degrees C, you can relieve stresses, those stress relief annealing. But if you want to get something different, you have to go into different zones. And it also becomes obvious that you can't achieve any grain structure with any material composition. You can achieve this, for example, only if you have a certain carbon content in your material. And if it's higher, you won't be able to get that just by applying heat. So, But that's really only to give you a general idea of how the structure and the properties in metals are dependent on the thermal treatment, meaning the cooling and reheating during additive manufacturing process, and also what we can do afterwards. And so here I compare the ultimate tensile strength, the yield stress, and the elongation of different samples that were produced with different processes. I'll explain that in more detail on a titanium alloy, because it's a really good overview. And I'm sorry, I can't remember where I got that from. So whoever made this and is not credited for, please let me know if you see this. But what we see here is the strength and elongation on the y-axis, and then the different different additive manufacturing processes and different traditional metal processing processes as well. So the additive manufacturing technologies we're looking at are direct energy deposition. We have direct metal deposition and lens, DMD and lens. And for powder bed fusion processes, we have direct metal laser sintering and electron beam melting. And then heat treatments that could have been done on it are HIP, hot isostatic pressing, and HT, just for heat treatment. Now let's look at the right side of this graph first, the cast, forged, and wrought, and annealed parts. So you see that they have all a certain, let's just look at the ultimate tensile strength and the elongation. They all have a certain value of the ultimate tensile strength, a little bit above 800 megapascals, and the elongation is relatively good, 15%, and for cast it's the lowest, it's more in the range of 10%. And when we just don't look at one particular process, we can see that always for the process, the 3D printing process, we get relatively low elongation and higher ultimate tensile strengths than we get for the traditional metal processes. And then you can see often the bar on the right shows some kind of heat treatment. For example, here the DMD process with hot isostatic pressing and a heat treatment, elongation goes up even higher than in a traditional metal process, which also costs us a little bit of the tensile strength. But overall, you can see that the elongation is mostly improved just with electron beam melting. You can see that the heat treatment is actually, or the HIP treatment is actually counterproductive, at least to a slight degree. In that process, you already get directly as printed a pretty a good structure with good properties. So the treatment itself doesn't improve that anymore. So this is just an example. The takeaway is, in general, we get as printed parts that have higher strengths but lower elongation at break if they're produced with additive manufacturing. And I hope that gave you an idea of some of the metal processes. And as we're moving along in the video series, you'll hear these pop up. And especially as I mentioned, not having worked as extensively with metals in additive manufacturing, I'm also inviting experts to join and talk about their expertise in this class of materials and with these processes.